Hi, this is Miesha Tate coming in from the Singapore HQ, speaking with the one featherweight world champion, Martin Nguyen. You're coming in from Sydney. How are you doing today?
Very well, very well. Got a few chores out of the way, and I get to kick back for the rest of the day now. So.
All right, nice. How is the spending more time with the family, you know, in light of the recent COVID-19 situation? How's it going with that?
It's pretty crazy. You know what? One thing I've learned from this is I respect teachers much, much more now. I have to homeschool my children, right? So just build that patience with them. But it's good to be home, good to see their faces again, and good to have their presence around.
What kind of projects are you working on? Are you refreshing your math skills or what?
Oh, man, everything from English to math to artwork, and I'm just giving him simple equations to work out. And I think patience is the main thing that we need with the kids. So
how have you been staying in shape? You know, obviously most of the gyms are shut down everywhere, so what's your remedy?
Yeah, so right at this moment I'm in isolation, so I can't leave this house for at least another 6 days. So as of when I landed back into Australia, I was doing my homework. I was just like your normal push-ups, your squats, your explosive push-ups to squat jumps. And I get some shadow boxing in there, just hand-eye coordination with a ball. Just simple stuff. And we have our strength conditioning coach from Florida. He sends me a workout as well that I have to get through.
All right. Well, speaking of Florida, you just came back from there. You were training with your teammates at Sanford MMA, and you were actually living there with Ang La and Teal Tang. So I don't know, just tell me a little bit about, you know, the bond that you guys have and that closeness that you share.
You know, it's you get asked this all the time. I feel like it's as simple as it is. We can just say like we are kind of like brothers, but in another way to explain it is that we're all going through the same journey, right? We're all trying to, you know, be the better person that we can be, sharpen our skills to the best that it can be, and, you know, ultimately provide for our family. So it's a bit of a sacrifice to be away from them. I know Ang's family's there with him, it makes it easier for him, but he still has a job to do, and me and Till have a job to do. And, you know, every day waking up, we have the same routine. We do the same things to keep it nice and simple, and just try to enhance our skills as much as we can.
So when I was speaking to Ang La the other day, he mentioned that at least when it comes to family, that they play a bit of games or whatnot. Was there any board games or anything like that you guys busted out in the kind of downtime, or any competitive?
We play a card game. It's called Skull King. So basically, we started off with Monopoly, and that was like cutthroat as it is.
That's what he told me. It was very competitive.
It's very, very competitive. Playing Monopoly alone is very competitive, and like everyone's, I don't know. I like Monopoly. I like playing it, but just the people that see Angler's stories say, "Well, we're sick of you playing Monopoly." One of his very close friends gave us a new game to play. It's called Skull King. And so we've been playing Skull King, and that there is another cutthroat game that ultimately is having all of us at each other's throats. So, I just recently had my high score beaten by Ang's wife, Katie. So I'm not too happy with that.
Oh, sounds like you have some work to do outside of that. All right, Martin, I want to switch gears a little bit to reflect on 2019. And you had a great 2019. You defended your featherweight strap twice, both knockouts. I'd like to take a look back at one bout in particular that I thought was standout against former world champion Narantungalag Jadambaa. And I'd love to go through round one and two with you. You were able to get it done inside two rounds, so I don't think this should take us very long. Shall we take a peek?
Sure, let's go.
All right, let's do it. All right, Martin, so this is the beginning of the match. I see you're just kind of pumping out your jab a little bit here. Bit of filling out process?
Yeah, it's always something that I do every single bout. I feel out my opponent, see what he's got, see what he's trying to threaten with, and I try to throw a lot of feints out there to get him triggered. And as you can see, I threw that leg kick. He didn't check it, so I was like, okay, this might work. And we'll go from there throughout the bout and see if it can land even more. we knew Jadambaa was going to be very explosive. So it was always the fact of keeping your guards high and countering as much as possible.
Okay, there you go again. You're switching up. So are you mostly trying to stay low? It looks like you're definitely attacking the lead leg. Or are you looking? Do you look to set up anything after you kind of get somebody distracted by leg kicks?
Being so early in the bout, like he has the most energy possible. I mean, we knew he was a good wrestler as well, so we tried to keep our base low and just keep attacking that left that lead leg to make sure that he hasn't got any pushing power when it comes to the takedown. Feint as much as possible, throw out the jab as much as possible, switch it up with the hands, with the legs, and ultimately I land a few more calf kicks on him, which will slow him down dramatically and make him think twice about coming in to the pocket.
Yeah, those are extremely effective for anybody who has never been kicked in the calf. I'll tell you right now, it works. And it seems like he's definitely thinking about it. You've landed a few solid ones. Anything that you particularly expected to work well in this? Was that one of the moves, or you just figured that out once the match began?
Yeah, just as you've seen there, we want him to push into the pocket where I take a step back and take the left hook. I keep still attacking that lead leg, which is going to make him want to actually rush me even more. And not if he backs up, then my game plan worked. I get to put the pressure on. But we know the type of fighter Jadambaa is. He likes to walk forward and he likes to walk his opponents down. So the moment he starts rushing in towards me, is we're going to catch him with a check left hook or just evade his attacks completely. As you see there, he came forward with one of his big hands and we had to get out of the way. The thoughts going through my head at that time is, this guy's got like bricks of hands, so we can't let him touch you at all. He's seen that my leg kicks were working, and so I assume that he's like, you know what, I'm gonna kick him back. And so it ended up being like a kicking contest, who can hurt each other when it came to those lead leg kicks. And I still pour the pressure on, and I'm just trying to keep him at bay still. So he doesn't utilize his game plan of putting the pressure on.
And so we're a little more than 3 minutes into the round. What do you feel like you've figured out at this point? He's throwing big overhand rights. He's trying to touch you back with a leg kick, but he doesn't seem like he's not quite as well timed or placed as you are. There he does land one. What are you figuring out here?
As of now, I know for a fact that every feint that I do, he's going to twitch on. And that there, I can start closing that distance even more. Every feint I do, he's going to take that step back ultimately until he's up against the cage and I can start landing some good flush shots. Jadambaa, he's got a warrior heart, man. He gets back, he goes back, and then he just switches and he comes straight forward. So it's still early in the fight. We've got 5 rounds ahead of us, and he starts working his game plan of just coming forward again and, throwing the leg kicks as what I was doing with him. So I just had to keep feinting and keep attacking, making him think twice, ultimately, so he can't get that takedown and that ground and pound in which he did the first bout. Oh, yeah, that one there, that really hurt me. That got me off guard because it was moving backwards and he hit that calf kick. So that stung, and I was like, you know what? This is my title. In my head, this is going through my, this is my title. Like, that hurt, but, a lot more things can hurt if I lose this title. So it was just a matter of weathering through that pain, keep my movement going. He's seen that I was hurt in that calf kick, and, this is where he starts pouring on and starts throwing, like, lower calf kicks himself. So it was, for me, I just keep my hands up, keep thinking twice, see if I can hit him with a counter, try to be in and out of the pocket, and hit him with a good left hook there, landed on his forehead. That one there, I was like, just before the round ended, he hit me with that calf kick. And that day I was like, oh, man. I went back to my corner, spoke to Angla. I was like, man, that one hurt. The last one. And, Angla's pep talk. Yeah, we got to do this. Think about your family. And from there, he started telling me the game plan. He tried to get me to sit down. I'm like, I'm all right. I'll stand it up and, let it flow out. And
did you stay standing so that you wouldn't get stiff, like the calf wouldn't stiffen?
Yeah, so what I learned from my previous bout against Kevin Benga, I got kicked in the calf and I sat down, and that's not something that I usually do, but when I sat down, just that lactic acid immediately went to that spot and my leg immediately bruised. So for me, I needed to keep moving on my feet, even if it's little steps here and there, and just keeping on top of my leg not being able to rest. And it ultimately worked out. Coming into that second round, I completely forgot about his kicks that he landed at the end of that round, and you know, I was fresh and ready to go again.
Martin, I want to touch on mentality. You know, you talked about pain. You're champ. Like, how did you go into the second round, knowing you took a little damage to that calf? Like, what goes through your mind for you to be able to deal with pain essentially in a match?
So that's where the corner comes in. Like, you tell your corner what hurts, what doesn't hurt, what. And you listen to the corner, oh, I just got kicked with an up kick there. That one there really surprised me. coming into that bout, I was like, you know what? I'll take it nice and smooth, and I got hit with an up kick. So, yeah, coming into the bout, the second round, I was like, you know what? The pain is only like, it's only a small fraction of this bout. And, you know, for me standing up, I instantly, it just ran through my body. I instantly forgot about it. From here, we're doing the same thing in the second round, keeping him at bay. I hit him with a good body kick with that left kick, and now just moving in and out. Still wary of his hands. We know, like, he's feinting that right, that left hand just to land that right hand. And, one of Jadambaa's punches can put you out. So we're trying to be in and out as much as possible. And, you know, get him frustrated. That's the main thing. Here, I switch it up. Every feint that I do, as I said, gets him moving. And he doesn't expect that feint. I hit him with that calf kick, which ultimately hurt him. Hit him with another calf kick there, which he started hopping, and...
Oh, my gosh. Beautiful. How do you practice that inside the gym? My goodness. And the emotions that must be flying through you there. I mean, you have successfully defended your world championship. You talked about physical pain and the match being, you know, such a small part of it. You're just kind of able to put it out of your mind. Here you are celebrating. There's your buddy, Angla. What's going through your mind right there?
Man, we've been saying it all camp. I said to myself, I'm going to knock this guy out. And like, it's easy to say it, but to do it in the circle, it's a different thing. But, you know, throughout the camp, the statistics behind Jadambaa, he's never been knocked out since 2012. You know, I started my professional fighting at 2012. So he's never been knocked out for, you know, there's 9 years, whatever it was. And, in my head, I was like, you know, I'm going to knock this guy out. All I got to do is touch him right, and I'll put him out. And we've been practicing that flying knee, me and my coach Kreiser, for about 5 years now. And I've never had the confidence to throw it. And up until I started working with Sanford MMA, with Henry Hoof, he started getting me used to throwing knees and elbows and just everything in general. And yeah, it just... When I seen Jadambaa just hopping back, man, I was like, yeah, it's now or never. Just go for it. Ultimately, I wanted to finish him with my hands, but if I land this knee, it might work out even more, you know?
I'm totally jealous. I wish I had an opportunity to land a flying knee like that at one point in my career, but that was a thing of beauty. Truly and a phenomenal technique. I still don't understand how you had the timing and placement for that. Very incredible, very impressive, Martin. You know, you have shown a lot of dominance in your division. Do you ever think about being a two-division world champion again?
Look, you know, that it's always, there's always a chip on my shoulder when it comes to holding a second title. But for me, ultimately, what wakes me up every day is taking out my next opponent, not holding another world title. So when that opportunity comes, then, you know, I'll definitely grab it with two hands. And I've definitely been in talks with one CEO, Chatri, about getting a rematch with Bibiana Fernandez at bantamweight. But as of now, I really want to focus on all the featherweights. I want to give every single featherweight contender a chance to win this title and for me to defend my title and my legacy. So as of right now, featherweight is where I am. Featherweight is who I'll be taking out. And up until I say I'm satisfied, then hopefully Bibiana's around and we can settle the score again. Even though he's beaten me once, but I feel like he only beat me from the 4 minute 30 second mark onwards to the last 30 seconds. So And so that's the chip on my shoulder that I have in that bantamweight division, and we'll go from there.
All right. Well, you're certainly proving to be a dominant world champion as the featherweight. Look forward to whatever's in your future. Martin, thank you for taking a moment to talk to me. Lastly, in closing, I'd love to know, you know, especially in this trying time, you know, a lot of people are frustrated or at home, or, you know, maybe just could be uplifted. You have so many fans around the world who really look to you for inspiration and draw from you. So do you have a message for your ONE fans here and now?
I just wanted to say, look, stay safe, stay clean. It's just a phase in life that we'll eventually get over together. The world will move on and we'll all get back to our normal lives. But as of now, just stay with family and just cherish the moments until, you know, life gets back on track and then the world goes on.
Absolutely. Words of wisdom. Thank you so much, Martin. It was really fun to sit down and watch one of your epic performances. Stay well, stay healthy, and we'll hear from you soon.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, guys.